Reprise du débat, resuming debate, the Honorable Parliamentary Secretary to the Minister of Justice.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Je suis ici aujourd'hui pour discuter du projet de loi d'initiative parlementaire C-375, loi modifiant le code criminel, rapport présentiel. Let me say at the outset that our government will be supporting Bill C-375, and we commend the Honourable Member from Richmond Hill for his leadership and collaboration on the important issue of mental health in our criminal justice system. And just before I continue with the substance of my remarks, I was listening very carefully to some of the concerns expressed by my Conservative colleague from the riding of Durham, and I think it's important to address the thrust of it. And that is that this private member's bill is somehow vague. In fact, on our interpretation of this private member's bill, it serves to clarify and cure a vagueness which is currently within the code, the criminal code, in the sentencing process by making an express reference to mental health concerns in the context of the criminal sentencing process. And what is important that my honourable colleague from across the aisle appreciates is that in that context, when we are talking about finding somebody not criminally responsible as a result of not having the mental capacity to appreciate the consequences of committing a criminal offence, that is a separate and distinct legal concept from the provisions under Section 718 and 721 of the Criminal Code, where after an accused individual pleads guilty and has accepted the responsibility for committing those offences, that in that context a judge would take into consideration mental health issues as part of the overall sentencing exercise. And I offer those comments in the spirit of constructive dialogue. So let me say to my honourable colleague from Richmond Hill that in the first hour of second reading of debate, the sponsor stated that his bill is intended to ensure that individuals with mental illness who find themselves in the criminal justice system are afforded the care, compassion, and appropriate treatment that they need during the process of their rehabilitation. Specifically, the bill aims to make the criminal justice system more responsive to individuals with mental health issues by amending Section 721 sub 3 of the Criminal Code to specify that a pre-sentence report must contain information regarding any mental disorder from which the offender suffers. Un rapport présentiel est un document écrit préparé par un agent de probation en vue d'aider le tribunal à en apprendre davantage sur la personne à condamner. Ce rapport a pour objet d'aider le tribunal à prendre la décision appropriée en matière de détermination de la peine. Ce rapport vise à fournir une évaluation précise, indépendante et équilibrée d'un délinquant et de ses perspectives pour l'avenir. Accordingly, they help to provide judges, these pre-sentence reports, with a firm evidentiary basis on which to exercise their discretion at sentencing. When judges are given the necessary background and context about each unique set of circumstances, the result is a sentence that better protects the community, rehabilitates the offender, and ultimately reduces crime. Le Code criminel précise actuellement que certains renseignements, incluant l'âge, le degré de maturité, le caractère et le comportement de délinquants et son désir de réparer le tort doivent figurer dans le rapport. It should also include the criminal history of the offender under the Youth Criminal Justice Act and the history of previous sentences and of findings of guilt, the history of alternative measures used to deal with the offender, and the offender's response to those measures should similarly be contained in the report. Those measures may include judicial cautions or programs requiring community service or repairing harm done. However, the Criminal Code does not presently expressly require that information about the mental condition or and as it relates to it, the offence of the offender must be included in the pre-sentence report. In my view, this is highly relevant information for a judge who is attempting to craft an appropriate sentence. Indeed, as we learn more and more about the role of mental health issues in contributing to criminal behaviour, the importance of considering this information at sentencing is beyond question. The impacts of mental illness are, of course, not limited to the criminal justice system, but are linked with much broader challenges being faced by our society as a whole. Today, mental health issues cost Canadians millions of dollars each year. As the sponsor has previously said, it is estimated that the total cost of mental health challenges exceeds $50 billion annually in health care expenses and lost productivity. According to the Canadian Mental Health Association, in any given year, one in five people in Canada will personally experience a mental health problem or illness. These challenges are even more pronounced in the criminal justice system. While statistics are not as fulsome as we may like, there is evidence to suggest that in our penitentiaries, mental health issues are 2 to 3 times more prevalent than in the general population. The rates of mental illness among federal offenders has more than doubled in the last 20 years. In fact, individuals with mental illness are more likely to be arrested, detained, incarcerated, and consequently more likely to be disciplined rather than being treated. This is an ongoing issue, as once they have been released from the criminal justice system, they are also more likely to be rearrested and to reoffend. In other words, an offender whose mental illness is unrecognized and untreated is at far greater risk of being caught in the revolving door of incarceration and repeat offending. C'est la raison pour laquelle nous devrons continuer à développer des mesures comme celles proposées par ce projet de loi afin de répondre de façon proactive aux enjeux liés à la santé mentale. Plus précisément, ce projet de loi permettra de veiller à ce que le tribunal puisse procéder à une meilleure évaluation des personnes à condamner et d'orienter ces délinquants vers les ressources de réadaptation appropriées. De cette façon, le projet de loi vise à mettre fin au cercle vicieux de la criminalité en adressant ce problème d'entrée de jeu. Mr. Speaker, the social and economic benefits of this smart and proactive approach to criminal justice can hardly be overstated. Under the prior government, we saw time and time again that a regressive approach to sentencing divides families and consumes financial resources that could be better used to improve the lives of Canadians and to keep all of them safe. Instead, by identifying and meeting the mental health needs of offenders in the short term, we can stop that revolving door of chronic reoffending and create a safer, more prosperous community for all. All of this begins by identifying the underlying problem, which is precisely what Bill C-375 works to ensure. Mr. Speaker, it appears to me that supporting this bill is consistent with a number of broader initiatives of our government which are aimed at supporting those mental health issues, and they go back to our prior budgets. In Budget 2018, we build on the investments made in past years, proposing an additional $20.4 million over 5 years, and beginning in 2018-19, that will be $5.6 million per year and ongoing. The funding is aligned with the recently announced investment of $5 billion over 10 years to improve mental health services across the country. Bill C-375 is also consistent with the mandate given by the Prime Minister to the Minister of Justice and Attorney General. In particular, she was directed to address gaps throughout the criminal justice system, and more particularly the gaps in services to those with mental illness. In my view, the measures proposed in Bill C-375 are consistent with that mandate and will serve to advance our government's broader plan to address the challenges related to mental health in Canada. Mr. Speaker, before concluding, I wish to draw to attention a few questions that I have identified with this bill. I'd like to think that these are issues which could be studied by the committee and possibly addressed through minor amendments. First, I note the bill focuses on the needs for a diagnosis of an offender and not on the symptoms or behaviours that manifest as a result of a mental health issue. In my view, it would be more useful to a sentencing judge to have broader information about the offender's mental health more generally rather than the official diagnosis. Secondly, I would note that the bill does not contain a link or a nexus between the mental health information that is sought and the purposes for which it will be used. For me, this raises some concerns that a sentencing court could be provided with mental health information which may not be directly relevant to the offence and therefore the sentencing process by extension. I trust that these are issues that the committee will address through its study. Finally, it seems to me that the language with respect to mental health, quote, programs, could create some confusion as to what type of information should be provided to the court. In my view, it is unclear what is meant by the term programs, as mental health care is indeed a specific type of medical care, and not specifically delivered through programming. Once again, I expect that all these issues can be thoroughly addressed at committee. Mr. Speaker, I would once again like to thank the sponsor of this bill and commend him for his work, his commitment to mental health issues. I know that it comes from a place of great sincerity, authenticity. I look forward to supporting this private member's bill, along with all members of this House. Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Resuming debate.